wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord our God. You reign forever, our hope, our strong deliverer.
You are the everlasting God, the everlasting God. Love me, your love never.
So I thought more about different things, and as I finally figured it out, I thought, you know, what we really need to see is some sunshine. Amen?
Amen.
We all need it. And every cowboy, I'm going to come, well, you'll see it on the screen. Every cowboy rides off into the sunset. So there you go. I got sunshine, sunset. There we go. Welcome your neighbor. The sunset.
Participated this year in the all-volunteer army. This is the first Sunday for Children's Church, which is for basically the up through third grade. The kids who were in the K-1 and 2-3. We got a big room back there waiting for you with games and stories. And it's taken us a year, I think, to figure out exactly what we need to do for Sunday school. But our average attendance was in the 20s. We sometimes had our greatest attendance, I think, was 37 kids. We were grateful for each and every one of them, but I was probably most grateful for the kids who showed up Sunday after Sunday. With that in mind, I asked the teachers to give me the names of the students in their classes who had been there the most. And not oddly, it came out to be two families. Because I think your mom or your dad or your grandma or somebody says to you each Sunday, this is the thing we do on Sunday morning. I know there are many other things we could be doing, but this is what we do. So my attendance awards here, which are a card and a little teeny gift certificate, go to Andrea, Melody, Austin, and Matthew Glenn, and Lee and Luke Kosowski.
To help to read the names on that card, and while she's reading that name, or before or after she reads that name, however that works, you're welcome to, I'll have a candle lighter right here. You can light one of these candles, doesn't matter which one to me. So you can light that candle in memory of your loved one. It doesn't have to be a military service personnel or someone from that branch of service. It can be anybody. It could be a spouse, it could be a child, it could be a friend. Someone that you want to remember today, but we invite you all to do that. Before we do that, I'm just going to read a little thing to get us started here. Also inside your bulletin, you'll find an insert about the memorial gifts given last year, the names of those, what they went to. The memorial committee decides, after receiving a request for a memorial gift, to purchase an item or so, they meet and they vote on that. And so here's what we did last year, a soundboard and the altar candles, which you see here, and also the Advent candles, which you saw last Christmas. We were able to acquire those before Advent started. So today, we are here to remember those we loved and who have died in this time. The center of our being and an awareness of the end to that valued relationship in which we shared, which we were a part of. Our hearts ache and our tears flow. We feel a deep, tender wound because someone precious to us is no longer walking this earth and a part of our life here on this earth as well. We grieve because of the physical absence, but we also rejoice and know that they were loved and they loved us. We rejoice also this day in the hope of the resurrection to eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. With that promise, we find the strength and the courage to rejoice this day. We find the strength and the courage to pray. We find the strength and the courage to remember. And in our grief, we will find the comfort, the peace that surpasses all understanding, that guards our hearts and our minds through our tears and through our memories. We celebrate today. We celebrate the hope that we will be reunited. And as we heard in that song in the beginning, though pain comes at night, joy will come in the morning. In the morning of the resurrection, when we are home at last, we will rejoice because we will gaze upon the one who made that possible, and we will gaze upon those who have gone home. As we light these candles today, may they be a reminder of the hope we have. In the rising of the sun and its going down, we remember them. In the opening of the bud and the rebirth of spring, we remember them. In the blueness of the skies and the warmth of summer, we remember them. In the rushing of the leaves and the beauty of autumn, we remember them. At the beginning of the year and when it comes to an end, we remember them. When we are lost, when we are sick, when we hurt ourselves, we remember them. When we have joys that we yearn to share, we remember them. As Christ lives, they too shall also live, because we remember them. As we come now, as we lift our hearts, let us do so in this moment with reverence, with tears, with laughter, with joy, with the hope. As we celebrate their life and for the lives that were sacrificed, that gave the greatest devotion that this nation might live. Let us remember them at this time. There's a couple of them here we will we'll lift up first, and as we light this candle.
Then we have Daniel Whiteside, Lisa Blankers, and that's from David and Linda Pyell. Pat and Don Trowbridge, Dorothy and Harley Boswell, and Abby Clayton, and that's from myself, Christine Meyer.
You would like to come now?
This is in memory of Dottie Johnson, Rose Guard, and that's by Alana Parm. This is in memory of Harold Bleichner by Ty McFarland. This is in memory of George and Virginia Ennis. This is by from Ruth and Diane. In memory of Tom Leslie, Lawrence Crapel, and Jackie Crapel. And that's by Lori Leslie. This is in memory of Ernie Sprout Jr. in the Marine Corps by Gail Sprout. In memory of Ed Lishman and Paul Hayes, given by Tom and Denise Hayes. In memory of George Canock and Marvin Stevens by Kent and Georgia Stevens. In memory of Ed Rushing, Beverly Olson, Jim Glenn. This is from the Glenn family. In memory of Malcolm Bollinger by Ruth Bollinger. In memory of Mary Lou and Ellery King and Bernard German by Terry German. In memory of Jack Wilson and Betty King, given by Jennifer Wilson. In memory of Gary Gorham, Greg Scotty, and Jason Coulter by Susan Gorham. In memory of Jack Perryman, Raleigh and Bonnie Flake by Nancy Perryman. In memory of Clarence Diver, given by Doreen Smith. In memory of Elmer Bayless, Mary Tracy, and Teresa Tracy, this is by the Tracy family. Roger Davis, Lisa Hansen, by Jason Hahn. In memory of John Dormeyer Sr., Mary Ann Parm, given by Hannah Parm. In memory of Robert and Virginia Schultz, Chester Payne and Roma Payne, given by Terry Schultz and Renee Schultz. This is in memory of the Dawson family, given by the Dawson. In memory of Howard Bedford and Marsha Wilkie, given by Lois Hill. This is in memory of Joanne and Ward Summers and Richard Whitney, given by Tracy and Doug Whitney. This is in memory of Don and Alice Forrest, given by Michelle and Don Forrest. In memory of Don and Dorothy Taylor and Dean Foreman, given by Dick and Gayla Taylor. In memory of Mom and Dad and Bill, by Joanne Endries. In memory of Joe and Virginia Roberts and Jeremy Roberts, by Jeff and Lisa Roberts. In memory of Mary and Max Shortness and Roletta Modis, by Janet and Ted Modis.
Anyone else that would care to come forward? The one candle in which was lit to light the other candles represents Christ. In the same way we light the Christ candle on Christ's birth on Christmas Eve, we are reminded this candle memorializes that light that is in the world, that same light that we carry, the light in which Christ says for us to carry into the world. And even though the light of those whom we love and have cared for have ventured on, their light still shines within us because of the light of Christ. Amen. As we turn now to this time of prayer, as we lift our hearts together, as we honor the Lord through our prayers, we will pause and lift our hearts as we remember them today, as we remember how they have touched our lives, the same way Christ has touched ours. So let us pray. Father, you have been good to us. Your word reminds us that through all generations, you are God. And that no matter what we experience in this life, no matter where we go, you are with us. Those who have served in the military, Father, we can't begin to say thank you enough for their service, for their sacrifice. For those that gave, as our once great President Lincoln said, the last full measure of devotion. Great is that commitment. That you even said, Lord Jesus, there is no greater love than those who lay down their lives for their friends. So for those that gave that sacrifice, we honor them today. We honor their memories. We honor their families. We say thank you once again. Those that have passed on that were a part of our family, and however we have known them, Father, we thank you for them. We ask that your peace and comfort be with each family today, that you would comfort each and every one of us as we turn to you, as we rely upon you. Find the comfort and the peace that we so desperately need. Lord, for the concerns that we have today for friends and family that are sick, for the concerns that we have for those within our community, for those that are mourning and those that are celebrating, for those that are hurting and those that are rejoicing. Father, we pray for them. For the needs of our home, for the needs of our family, for those that are in the midst of tests and trials, and those who are in the midst of taking medical treatments and seeking medical advice, Father, we pray for them. For those that are traveling, for those this day who do not know you personally, we pray for them that they may come to know the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Father, we turn to you with our prayers for our nation, for our world, for our military, for their families, for those that could not be here today, for those that need you the most right now, and those that think they need you the least. We pray. We offer our prayers. We do so in the name of Christ, our Savior and Lord, who is the light of the world, who lights our way, and who taught us how to pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And now, as we lift out our hearts in prayer to the Lord, let us lift our ears and our minds and our hearts as well to hear the word of God.
Morning.
Morning.
Today's scripture comes from Nehemiah chapter 1, verses 2 through 11. Bear with me. Hanani, one of my brothers, came from Judah with some other men, and I questioned them about the Jewish remnant that had survived the exile and about Jerusalem. They said to me, Those who survived the exile and are back in the province are in great trouble and disgrace. The wall of Jerusalem is broken down and the gates have been burned with fire. When I heard these things, I sat down and wept. For some days I mourned and fasted and prayed before the God of heaven. Then I said, Lord, the God of heaven, the great and awesome God who keeps his covenant of love with those who love him and keep his commandments. Let your ear be attentive and your eyes open to hear the prayer. Your servant is praying for you day and night, for your servants, the people of Israel. I confess the sins we Israelites, including myself and my father's family, have committed against you. We have acted very wickedly toward you. We have not obeyed the commandments, decrees, and laws you give your servant Moses. Remember the instruction you gave your servant Moses, saying, If you are unfaithful, I will scatter you among the nations. But if you return to me and obey my commands, then even if your exiled people are at the furthest horizon, I will gather them from there and bring them to the place I have chosen as my dwelling for my name. They are your servants and your people, whom you redeemed by your great strength and your mighty hand. Lord, let your ear be attentive to the prayer of this your servant and the prayer of your servants who delight in revering your name. Give your servant success today by granting him favor in the presence of this man. I was cupbearer to the king. May the Lord and his blessing in the reading of his word.
We are discouraged. I think we all need and desire that moment when we hear from somebody, you got this. You can get through this, or I've got your back, or you're going to be okay, or I'm here for you. I think we all need to hear those words when we are discouraged. And we want to hear those words from God that say, take courage through all of this. Take courage, find strength, find courage in the midst of this pain, in the midst of this problem. And maybe for somebody here today, you're facing that discouraging moment. Maybe you've been through it, or maybe you are going through it, or maybe you are about to go through it. But there is that discouraging moment that we all struggle with. And today we're going to look at a man that was in the midst of a great discouraging moment. We're going to look at a man, how he handled this situation, and how we are called to do the same, to handle the discouragements in our lives. Now, imagine a moment to help illustrate this. Imagine a moment that you went to a movie theater, and there's two seats left, they're right in the middle, okay?
But completely filling that movie theater is, well, some rather hard living folks that might scare you, that might maybe even just encourage you to just leave. And there was a commercial produced over in England for a beer company of all places about that very situation. So watch this video. Your seats, what do you think you're going to find? Nothing! No, I'm not going to put beer underneath your seats unless you want me to leave or get kicked out of the church or something. But, you know, when I saw this commercial and I saw this, I got to thinking, wow, that took a lot of courage. Now, how many of you noticed that the guy let the wife go first? Or kind of hid behind him, you know, it was going to be a kick butt moment, right? But there they are. You know, about 1,000 years after the time of Moses and about 400 years before the time of Jesus, the city of Babylon, the children of Israel, the people of Israel were in captivity. They had been vanquished. The northern Israel kicked the people out of Jerusalem, and then the southern division kicked the people out of Israel, and over a major time of skirmish and fighting. And so about 100 years had passed. There had been people living there. Some of the first people from the first exile were able to make their way back to Jerusalem, but they found it in a mess. They found the walls were destroyed. They found that all of this was in ruins. But they chose to remain there and live there. And this city was defenseless because the walls were destroyed. There's huge gaps in the walls where any enemy could just literally walk right in and take captive of those people or take control of that city. And these people had been living there for years, and Hanani, the brother of Nehemiah, and several other men had ventured to Jerusalem to see the city for whatever reason they were going. And they got there and they took report of what they saw. They saw the people living in disgrace. They saw the people living defenseless. The city in which God had ordained as the holy city stood in ruins. And so they came back, and it's about a 4-month journey from where Nehemiah is and where Jerusalem is. So Hanani comes back, and he brings this report to Nehemiah. Now Nehemiah is just a cupbearer. He's the guy that makes sure there's no poison in the drink for the king. You know, it's kind of a, it's a very prestigious job, but if you mess up, just like that, you lose your life. It's a very humbling job, and he needs to be with the king at all times in order to make sure that the drink is not poisoned, to make sure that he's safe. So Nehemiah gets this report. What's amazing about this, what I find interesting, is how Nehemiah responds to this report. He hears about Jerusalem, about the walls being destroyed, and how it is all in shambles, and how the people are disgraced. And this graphic, firsthand description speaks to Nehemiah's heart, and he looks at this. He looks at his brother. He looks at these men who bring this report. And he doesn't shrug his shoulders. He doesn't pick up his shoulders and just acts like, well, what am I going to do about that? He doesn't say, oh, well. It says, Nehemiah wept. Now, for sure, the Jewish people in Jerusalem were in a desperate state. And I think when we look at this in our own lives, we can be as well. We can see this in our own lives. We can see, I think I would venture to guess that we have all experienced desperate moments in our lives. We have all experienced some sort of desperation. Now, maybe we're desperate for something. You know, there's times in my life I'm desperate for a Reese's peanut butter cup. Anybody else relate to that? Yeah, there they go. Look at them hands go up. They're not under your seat either. So, if they were, I'd be out there. We've all been desperate, but I think the word desperation really more entails a situation that we'd rather not be in, that we would rather not experience in our lives. We don't want to be in desperate situations where we're trying to find the answer to something, or where we're seeking something to get it resolved, or we're so desperate looking for an answer that we don't know where to turn. We don't like those desperate moments. About 18 years ago, I was in a desperate moment. I was on the way home from the hospital. Our son Daniel had just been born. Now he was about 4 to 6 weeks early, a preemie. And we kind of had an idea, okay, this is going to be a little more difficult situation, and, you know, we get it. He's going to go down to the NICU unit, and we're going to be there probably a week or two. It wasn't but just a few hours after he was born, I would say probably about 4 to 5 hours, the nurse came in and said, the doctors want to come in and talk to you. Okay. The doctors came in and told me to sit down. He said, you'll want to sit down. At that moment, I started shaking. What's going on? The doctor said, your son has an infection. And this is why he was born early, because the body was rejecting him. And we are not certain he's going to survive this. One doctor says, if you believe in prayer, or you believe in God, or you have a God, now is the time to pray. One and I looked at each other, and we looked at them and said, what are you talking? I mean, what, are you giving us a time frame or something? He said, I give him 2 days, tops. If we can't stop this, and history has shown we cannot stop this. And I was just getting ready to leave to go back to the congregation in which I was serving, because I had a parishioner that was dying at the moment. And I was going back to change clothes so I could go be with that family for a few minutes. I was going back to get clothes for Linda. And I looked at Linda after the doctors left and we prayed. And I said, you want me to go home? And she said, go get clothes. I need clothes. You need to go and be with this family. We're just going to trust God on this. As I drove home, I can recall very fondly going across the one, I call it the 150 bridge. Get off to go through Metamora and on up to Washburn where I was serving. And traveling that bridge, I cried out and wept to God. Yes, big boys do cry. I cried out to God and I called out to God and I pleaded with God and I played Let's Make a Deal. And I prayed and I wept. God, don't take our son from us. We've been waiting for him so long. God, we have dreams for him, but what are your plans for him? Is your plans for him to come and to die? I don't get it, God. And I went through every emotion of grief that you could go through. I went through the anger, through the deal making and the whole thing. So I got to Washburn. I pulled in. There was a lady from my church. She was out working in the yard. And she was trimming the bushes and stuff. She saw me get out of my car and she came right over and she said, congratulations. And I said, thank you. I said, we hope and pray Daniel's going to be okay. And she just looked at me and she said, does Jesus have this? And I said, yes. She said, then he'll be okay. No matter what, Pastor, he'll be okay. Now, I can't tell you exactly what I prayed on that day, what I prayed for, and what I prayed to ask God to do, but I will tell you something. From that moment, I got onto that bridge, and from that moment on, I have never felt the presence of God closer to me than in that moment. I've never felt the surrounding, embracing arms of God more thick than at those moments. And that was powerful to me. And every day, people pray in a desperate moment, just like I did on that bridge. Every single day, I've had the privilege and the honor to be with you in those moments. Every day, we lift our hearts. People face those desperate moments and it's because someone they love is sick or because they have died or because they are dying or because of some bad news or whatever it is, or maybe it's even in their own personal life, those desperate moments. We have all cried out to God just like Nehemiah. We have all wept. As my grandmother used to say, some tears are sweet and some tears are bitter. We all know those moments. We all react to those moments differently. And Nehemiah's reaction to the bad news he hears is a great example for us about what to do when we face desperate situations. Nehemiah shows us what to do when we face desperate situations. Shows us how to do that. It says that he prayed. After being told that the news of Jerusalem, that the walls were destroyed, that the people were in distress, Nehemiah responded with prayer. It says here in verse 4, take a look at that. It says, as soon as I heard, this is Nehemiah speaking, as soon as I heard these words, I sat down and what? Nehemiah sat down and wept. And for a few hours, for a few days. And I continued what? Fasting. That means to turn our focus off ourselves, to turn our focus off our situation, and to turn our focus onto God. Now, that means to give, in those days, and that understands to give up food for a period of time. We can still fast and pray. A lot of people fast from television, amen? And how many do we know need to fast from Facebook? We can fast from the computer, from television, from our shows, or from whatever it is that takes our attention away from God. And Nehemiah said, you know what? I'm not going to focus on that. I'm going to fast. I'm going to trust the God. And he prayed for the God of heaven. This gives us a great idea. Yes, it's okay to weep. Yes, men, it's okay to cry. I cry a lot. I cry for you at times. I cry for our world. I cry for our nation. I cry for our president. Yes. I cry for our government. I cry for our leadership. I cry for the church. And Nehemiah fasted and prayed, and he did what he did for people he did not know, for a situation he could not control. That took courage. That took a great amount of courage. That takes courage for us to pray. How many know sometimes it takes really a lot of courage to pray? It takes a lot of courage to build up that moment, that faith. Because maybe at that moment we are angry with God for what is going on. Or maybe for that moment we are thinking we can control it or handle it. So it takes courage. No matter what you're going through, you can look in the scriptures and you can see story after story after story of people that gave of themselves, but they did the same thing Nehemiah did. They prayed in their situations. They didn't allow, some did allow the last resort to be prayer. And it showed the problems and the hardships they went through. And some allowed it to be the first resource, the first response. And how God walked them through that battle. Now, just because you pray about a situation doesn't mean God will stop the situation. Amen? But God will give us the peace, the strength, the courage, the hope to get through that situation. That's what God does. The courage that we find in those moments to pray is the same courage that causes us to do great and wonderful things. Now, if we were to compare our lives, to Jerusalem, if we were to compare our lives to what was going on in Jerusalem, I think we could all safely say there's been moments when the walls of our defense have been broken down to defend us from the pains of this world. Maybe the walls of defense against the evil one have been broken down, and we're in situations where we are addicted to something that has been allowed in. We feel that the very situation in which we are a part of, we are defenseless too. So did Nehemiah just quit, shrug his shoulders and say, what am I going to do about this? These are people I don't know. This is a situation I have nothing to do. It's been 80 years. I wasn't even around then. What am I going to do about this? The thing is, it takes great or remarkable courage to care about someone other than ourselves. It takes remarkable courage to care about a situation other than our own situation. It takes incredible courage. And those we remember today as we've lit those candles, here's what we remember. We remember their courage to face life's challenges. We remember the courage it took to risk and to find hope. We remember their courage to have faith. We remember their courage to sacrifice. We remember the courage that you have shown to come and light their candle and to remember. We remember the courage you have shown in their death or in their passing. We remember the courage you show today just by being here. Just by being here. Archie Miles, who will be buried here, lost his life over in Hawaii at Pearl Harbor. And his remains are being brought here to be buried at the request of his family. Today we remember Archie, that it took incredible courage for him to take a pen and sign his name as he entered United States Navy. You remember today that it took great courage to stand his post while the bombs were dropping, and the torpedoes were being launched as the ship he was on was sinking. I heard so many stories this past week. I think about my own father's courage as he stormed that beach of Normandy as a part of the Navy as well. I met one of the gentlemen yesterday from the Navy, and he talked about his father being in the Navy and risked his life. His father passed away just a few years ago, and so did mine. But I also remember today the courage that my sister made in the decision to discontinue treatments and to trust where God was taking her next. And as I held her hand in that hospice room, she embraced mine and I embraced hers. And the last words we spoke just a few days before she passed, she said, "I love you, and I get to see Jesus first." That took courage. So today, Nehemiah put that situation, was put into a situation that he had not planned. He was put into a situation that he had a choice to be courageous or to not. Let me ask you, because it takes remarkable courage to care about someone other than ourselves, but let me ask you this question. Where is courage given an opportunity in your daily life? Where is courage given the opportunity in your life? There's an old saying that desperate times call for desperate measures. That's right. And I get that. I don't 100% agree with it, but I get it. But here's what I would rather say. Desperate times, let's go ahead and look at that here. Desperate times call for the courage to pray. And that's what we're going to do today and each day. What is it your situation is going through right now? Do you need prayer? I know I do. I'm so grateful when I got back to the church that day, about 18 years ago, that lady was right there in that lot. She said, "Pastor, Jesus has got this. It's going to be okay no matter what." That was that moment I needed. You got this. With Christ, you've got this. And so today I will tell you, you've got this. They gave their lives. Some lost their lives to illness. Some lost their lives to service in the military. Some lost their lives for other natural causes, whatever it is. But that I believe in eternity, there's a great cloud of witnesses, and they're in the cheering stands right now, and they're cheering us on because we're still in the game, and they're chanting and cheering over and over and over again, "Take courage. You got this. Take courage. You got this. Take courage. You got this." And Jesus is saying to us, to them and to us, "They do because of me." Amen?
Amen.
Let us pray. So Father, we thank you for the courage that you give to us, because desperate times call for the courage to pray. Because there are moments in our lives we just don't. We just don't know what to pray. Maybe that fear puts fear into our hearts. There's times when we don't know what to do, puts fears into our hearts. But we know that today, because of the day you have given to us, we have strength. Because of you and your great love, we take courage in you. We take strength in you as we trust you in Jesus' name. Amen. Our ushers will come now. Let's give to God as God gives to us. Thank you.
kind of mashup between good old him and he was him back to Sunday after Easter, so if you want to do it then, and maybe you want to, it went over pretty well. Fits the team together for overcoming our fears. That amazing grace that gives us the power to our Lord Jesus Christ to overcome about anything. And this went over so well, even Ted Lawrence was saying,
that it takes. Amen. Go